likely be heading towards the cross. And in John chapter 13, he goes through the Lord's Supper with his disciples. Following that, he speaks to them in John chapter 14, verse 1, "Let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me." John chapter 15, he speaks to them about the vine and how that it is absolutely vital, if a branch is to have life, that it be plugged in to the vine and that it bear fruit that draws its sap, that it draws its strength from that vine, and that Christ is the vine and that we are the branches. Jesus would go on to continue to invest in his disciples and to pour into them, knowing how that their world would be utterly shattered. And then he comes to John chapter 17, just before they head out of that upper room and head across the Kidron Valley and into the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus, in John chapter 17, he prays for his disciples. He offers what is so frequently called the high priestly prayer. I think it's vitally important and very significant that prayer is the final thing that Jesus did for his disciples. He poured into them. He invested in them. He had instructed them over a period of about 3 years, and ever so much he had poured into them in those final few moments, knowing how that they would be rattled, how that they would feel that their whole world had collapsed under them. He pours into them and he brings them before his heavenly Father in prayer. And once again, all of the investment and all of the strength, he says, "Lord, would you so watch over this and stabilize and strengthen and uphold these ones whom I love so dearly?" Let's take a look very quickly at this high priestly prayer, and let's consider the first 12 verses, about the first half of what Jesus prays here to his heavenly Father, and the things that he says he has done and those petitions that he asks for. Jesus was desperately concerned that these ones go forward with strength and that they know that they are not alone. In John chapter 17, verse 4, Jesus says, "I glorified you on the earth." He's speaking, of course, to his heavenly Father. "Having accomplished the work which you have given me to do." Glory is a key word in the whole Gospel of John. John uses it many times, speaking of the glory that was revealed, the glory that was shown forth. And Jesus says, "Father, I have done this. I have accomplished the work that you have given me to do. The glory which we shared in eternity past, I have brought it to this world. And though it was cloaked in humanity, yet it burst forth in the teaching that was given, in the miracles that were effected, and most especially in the grace that was shown that Jesus Christ would die upon Calvary's cross for lost sinners who had no hope in and of themselves. Jesus says, "I glorified you on the earth." Indeed, that had taken place. Secondly, Jesus says in verse 6, "I have manifested your name to the men whom you gave me out of the world." The believer in Jesus Christ is one who has come out of the world. You see, we no longer believe as the world believes. We are no longer an integral part of this world system because we have truly been called out by the very Spirit of God to live according to a different standard, washed by a different detergent than this world knows about, washed by the very blood of Jesus Christ. And Jesus says, "I have manifested." He was cracking the door open all the way through his earthly ministry for these disciples, especially who had the privilege of that front row seat, for them to see, for them to understand the manifestation of the Son of God. And Jesus says, "I have manifested your name," that glorious name, to those whom you have given me out of the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Thirdly, Jesus in verse 8, he says, the words which you gave me, I have given to them. Jesus is saying, I have instructed them. I have poured blessing into them, and they are now going to go out into the world as witnesses of mine, and they will bear witness of my glory, which was the very radiance, the very glory which you gave to me. Jesus says, I have given to them those blessed words, and they received them, and truly understood that I came forth from you, and they believed that you sent me, that I am indeed your emissary. Fourthly, Jesus says in verse 9, I ask on their behalf. I do not ask on behalf of the world, but of those whom you have given to me, for they are yours. Do you know that Jesus most especially prays for those of us who are believers in his name? There is that special relationship. Yes, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. But once we come out of the world, out of darkness, and we become his very own, we are members of the family of God. And it is a high and holy privilege that is ours to come into the presence of God and to know the strength, to know the blessing, to know that our Savior, our great elder brother, is praying for us. Hear Jesus, he prays for his disciples. Do you ever feel that you are absolutely alone, that no one cares for you? Jesus, our great intercessor, he is praying for you before the very throne of his heavenly Father. I ask on their behalf. And finally, in verse 11, Jesus, the fifth point that I want to give to you, he says, I am no longer in the world, and yet they themselves are in the world. Jesus had a special concern for these ones whom he was leaving behind, whom he would send the Holy Spirit to, that it might dwell and that it might empower them. Jesus was especially concerned for them. Father, I am no longer in the world. I am coming to you. But these gathered around this table, they are still here, and Lord, they need your mighty power if they are to carry out the work that you have given me to give to them to do. I am no longer here, yet they are. And Lord, I pray that you would keep them in your name, the name which you have given me, that they may be one even as we are one. I would encourage you how that Jesus loves you, how that he cares for you. If you are not a part of the family of God, why don't you come to call upon the name? But know that for the believer, what a privilege, what an honor it is that we should be so treated by our great Lord and our great Savior, Jesus Christ.
There's room at the cross for you.
Thank you for joining Pastor Barber today. Please watch for Faith to Live By again next Sunday at this same time on this same station. Until then, Faith to Live By prays that the peace of God will fill your heart and that the joy of the Lord will be your strength. Pastor Barber would love to hear from you. The mailing address is Faith to Live By, Box 426, Winnipeg, Manitoba, R3C2H6.